they depend on the length of the particles, and ethnicities or spin, depending on the particles of mass. The mass of the new property gives the other property that when you do a large fractionation on their mass, they pick up a little group fractionation on the little group of ethnicity or spin. And I emphasize that again, that's why you probably never seen an actual amplitude in your life. Because at least when you have particles of spin, you've probably only seen a redundant representation of it, where you've got into particles of spin. And maybe even for spin half, you've got into these U bars and Vs and the spaces of the application. But you have to get the final actual amplitude looks like in the actual amplitude. So that's what we want to solve in this lecture. And I want to show you a number of ways it works. We want to see what our properties actually functions are. And they're not functions of momenta, but they are functions of the sort of square root of momenta, and these are the famous spinability. And I first want to talk about them in the context in which it's more or less standard, and you know we're going back to the 80s for massless particles. And then we'll talk about the Fourier extension to massive ones. Okay, so we're going to begin by the fact that knowing the fact that in four dimensions there is a canonical way of going from a four vector to you, whether it's massive or massive, it doesn't matter. Any four vector to you, we can associate it with a 2x2 matrix, 2 alpha alpha dot, which is the Pauli matrices alpha alpha dot to you. Okay, how many people are familiar with this? Okay, for those of you who aren't familiar with it, let me just show this. Over here. So, imagine you have any vector, any two vector, any four vector, to you. Essentially, with this, I can build the following 2x2 matrix. Which is, I can also write as 2-0 times the identity plus 2. What's useful about doing this? By the way, maybe you're more familiar with this in the context of ordinary rotations, which is one of the practical ways of seeing the spin-off representation of just the ordinary rotation group. There you saw this on vector v, and you associated it with sigma dot v. Which is v3, v1 minus rv2, v1 plus rv2, and minus v3. So, this is the analog of this operation, except now for the range group. Now, let me call that matrix, script 2 here. The important point is that this matrix, script 2, it's the tournament is equal to 2-0 squared minus 2 vector squared. So it's 2-0, 2-0 plus 2-3 times 2-0 minus 2-3 minus the other two guys, so it's exactly 2-0 squared minus 2 vector squared. Which is 2-0-2-0, which is the 1-0-2 squared. Also notice that this matrix T, this matrix T is in fact the most general 2x2 Hermitian matrix that I can possibly have. Any 2x2 matrix is a good form where I can just represent the diagonal components as a sum of a different scalar. Okay? And so, if I say, given any 2x2 Hermitian matrix, there is a 4x2 that goes along with it. So, let me look at the matrix 2 times, which is all of the this is another permission to buy two matrix. But it is also a permission to buy two matrix. And therefore, I can write it as some 2 prime a new sigma mu. Okay? No matter what power is, power doesn't have to be unitary. I'm not saying power is unitary, but I am going to say that power is just a general 2 by 2, general complex 2 by 2 matrix. That was unit determinant. That's the best of the test. So that power is equal to 1. But that's it. That is it. So, because dot p, so dot p prime is just equal to dot p. So, since dot r equals 1. And therefore, p prime squared is equal to p squared. And so, we discovered that p prime is some current expression that's acting on p. So, that's dot p. So, p prime is some Lorentz transformation acting on p. And so we have a representation of a Lorentz group associated with any 2 by 2 matrix with unit determinant. Okay? Again, are you happy with this now? And if you're familiar with the analog exercise for rotations, we just updated to the Lorentz group. Just for some practice, what do the L's look like that correspond to rotations? Anybody? This is a different thumb victim for this. So L is just unitary. So L is happens to be not just unitary. So L does not be unitary, but those L's that are unitary correspond to the usual rotations. What does a boost in the Z direction look like? What does the L matrix look like in that case? That's really just in the Z direction, you didn't think that. It's just something that looks like, you know, X, one of the X on the diagram, so the determinant is one. Or E to the eta, E to the minus eta, if you want to work in terms of what it is. And you see, that's exactly P0 plus P3 goes to E to the eta, P0 plus P3, P0 minus P3 goes to E to the minus eta. These are the that's exactly what the rotations. Okay? So the compact part of the SRT are the ordinary rotations, the non compact part are the boosts that you would expect. Okay? Oh, now, while we're at it, let me just say a few more things, just a few more things quickly about this. So, so we see that the Lorentz group is SRPC. Now, if we have a complexified Lorentz group, in other words, we say that PU is complex. Now, if the PU is complex, none of this I doesn't mean anything, right? If it's complex, I represent a totally general 4 by 4 complex matrix. In that case, the complexified Lorentz group, this is going to be dogged. It's just any transformation that preserves P squared, any complex transformation that preserves P squared. So the most general transformation that I can have would be P, which is from left to right dogged. So you have to write that. That's going from left to right. Okay? So the complexified Lorentz group, there is 2 copies of SRPC. We're going to be imagining complexifying everything in time, okay? Because ultimately, all the objects that we're writing down, all the formulas we're writing down, are going to be simple formulas, polynomials. Maybe at loop level, you get slightly more interesting functions like log and dialog and so on. But they're naturally functions of the complex way. Nowhere are we going to see something like magnitude, okay? This is things that don't have analytic configurations, right? This is step function. Now, there's a deep reason for this, is that the causality of scattering amplitudes is reflected in the fact that the amplitudes are analytic, or analytic enough. So that's what's allowing the complexification, at least with zero order. But anyway, that's a personal fancy for that. Just really just practical speaking, all the formulas are obviously valid even if they're not good. That's in fact going to be very useful thing to keep in mind. Finally, what if we're in the standard landscape in 3-1 signature? What if we're in 2-2 signature? This is another nice case. The 2-2 signature is a case where P is just a general 2-by-2 real matrix. And then I can write P as like, I can write it as, let's say, if I wanted to write it in the same way, it could be P3, P1 minus P2, P1 plus P2, no I, P0 minus P3, just differently the I's. And you see that the determinant of P has 2-2 signature. It's P0 squared minus P3 squared minus P1 squared plus P2 squared. So there's 2 times in 2 spaces. Okay? And in this case, I'll put it up here. So in this case, in 2-2 signature, the landscape is just SL2R plus SL2R. And we'll sometimes go back and forth. So, that's what it's going to be to do. And so, finally, we're going to do the next part of the notation that P is P0 plus P3, P1 minus IP2, P1 plus IP2, and P0 minus P3. Then P alpha alpha dot are just the components of this matrix. Okay? So, literally, this is alpha equals 1, alpha equals 2, alpha dot equals 1, alpha dot equals 2. Okay? So, when we write this, so P 1 1 dot would be P0 plus P3. Okay? The reason for putting that dot on there is to remind you that there is no symmetry between the indices. The matrix isn't symmetric. It's a real general complex momentum. It's not even symmetric. There's no relationship between the two indices at all. Okay? And so, under SL2 plus SL2, SL2 plus SL2 is just this act of some relationship, some 2-by-2 linear transformation on alpha and beta, and this one of some thing that I typically develop alpha beta, and the other one I'll typically denote by putting a tilde on it whenever it's done. Okay, so I just have two different 2-by-2 matrices of unit decay. Okay, is that clear? Anything about this notation not clear? Yeah, let's just talk about the momentum that I was in the end. So it's just, this might give you a completely general 2-by-2 matrix with complex entries. Okay? And I'm interested in finding the complexified Lorentz transformations are those complex transformations that map a complex form momentum into another complex form momentum such that P2 is equal to the vector state. Okay? And the complexified will be called Euclidean, Minkowski, it's all a matter of just putting some extra eyes in it. Okay, they're all there. So there's one big complexified. And this makes it clear that complexity landscape is associated with two properties of SL2. So it's simple to P2 signature, but everything becomes real, and so those two SL2s become independent real 2-by-2 matrices of unit determinant. And Minkowski case is a case where the conjugate 2-by-2, where the matrix T is a neutron, and so the R and the R are conjugate 2-by-2. Okay? Any questions? Yes. Yes, exactly. Yes. So, T alpha alpha dot goes to L alpha beta or L dot alpha dot beta dot something. T beta beta dot. And again, I know we're supposed to be ashamed to admit these things, but, you know, if you haven't done it, things that are going right on those two one guys. There's nothing special about them. So, breathing the shot. If you haven't done it, just to make sure that you're always happy with all of it. Something I really encourage you all to do if you haven't done it is just to read Einstein's notebooks and whether it's connecting between notebooks. Okay? And especially with those work notebooks. Because every single thing that students are confused about in their written GR, Einstein is confused about. Okay? And so, it's going to be the first time to then look it up and take a look at the same year. So, he spends like a few pages running to read and learn. He says, what are you doing? And I just emphasize that it's not an abundance that I can give you choice. But I want to say, I'm not unconstrained. I can give you one round of my program and two is guaranteed to be more. Right? How many degrees of freedom are there in round and round of program? There are two in round and two in round of program. So it seems that there's still 4 degrees of freedom here. So what's going on? We know there's only 3 degrees of freedom in the Armstrong mass force momentum. So why do they expect them to be 4? Exactly. Because in fact, there's no unique way of associating a lambda and a lambda tilde with a T. Okay? If you give me one way, I can give another way where it's still lambda to some T lambda. Lambda is from little W inverse lambda and lambda tilde to little W lambda tilde. Okay? This means two invariants. So there is a unique way of associating a lambda and a lambda tilde. Now we're going to get into Now, let's think a little bit more about this. When I write this for a formula, in C1 signature, so in general complex, lambda and lambda tilde are independent complex variables. In C1, lambda tilde alpha dot has got to equal lambda alpha complex conjugate in order for P to be Hermitian. Okay? So that really means lambda tilde 1 dot is lambda 1 star. Okay? In P2, lambda and tilde are independent and real. But if I focus for a second on P1, if I want to stay in P1 signature, there's a constraint on this W. What is the constraint on the W? I must have W inverse equals W star. This implies W equals VI theta is a phase. Okay, so now what is this all reminding you of? We have something, some transformation, the reason, the method of the particle invariant, but it's a phase. That's exactly the action of the rule group for a mass force particle. So, in fact, these lambda and lambda tilde are the objects we've been looking for. What are the things that transform under the middle group and the Lorentz group? Now, I'm going to leave this to you as an exercise, partially because it's the object of our sex to the object, and leave it for you to fill out, partially because we might hear some of this in the discussion of the middle group. But I want you to really prove to yourself that. But the transformations and the lines we're talking about really are the little bit. Let me be more specific about how that works. In order to see the connection directly, we want to mimic exactly the same steps that we went through in thinking about the little bit, except it's very motivated from this point of view as well. What we're going to do is teach first a reference in my pen, and for this reference in my pen, I'm going to just choose some lambda A and lambda tilde alpha dot. To represent it. I'm going to pick one choice, any way of doing it. Okay? So again, it's not unique, but I'll just choose one. Okay? So here you find my choice. Alright? And once again, I will write P as power of P and K, and I'll use that to define what lambda and lambda tilde are for general momentum P. By definition, again, just like we did for the space with the energy, I'll define lambda for P to be definition, to be the Lorentz definition that goes along with this one. Alpha, Beta, Lambda, Beta 2, and similarly for Lambda, Delta, Alpha, Dot, E, Delta, Alpha, Dot, Beta, Dot, Lambda, Delta, Beta, Dot. Okay. So now that's just a definition for it's not unique. I don't know how to. I can't uniquely associate line-to-line tokens. I'm going to pick a way of doing it, right? I'll pick any way of associating line-to-line with table with NP. And now, there's a non-trivial question, which is, what is lambda alpha of lambda P? So, is this equal to the corresponding 2 by 2 line transmission that goes along with lambda times lambda beta of P? And of course, the answer is no, it is not. Okay? It's not that, but it is that up to a factor of W inverse, which depends on lambda and P on the first. And you can show that the W that appears there is exactly the W that appears for the big. So it's literally the action of the building. Now, in the amplitude 0, so people hardly install this out, because it's kind of obvious what else could it be. So, especially if you imagine that you do a Lorentz transformation that uses momentum invariant. But again, if you just do what we talked about before, do a rotation around the z-axis, and the particle moving in the z-direction, clearly it uses momentum invariant, but clearly that rotation is e to the I theta e to the minus I theta, right? E to the I theta over 2, e to the minus I theta over 2, and so it's rotating via particle. Exactly, the W is exactly what it is. E to the I theta over 2, E to the I theta over 2. Okay, so it's about 5 minutes. Okay, so this is what's going on in general. And if you go through this exercise and your graph I grades over in the last lecture, then if you force them open long enough to complete this exercise, you will repeat what we did in the last lecture. Okay? But this is a meaningful sense in which the spin ocean variables are the objects that amplitudes depend on. Now, this is an important point for me to ask the questions about. Okay? Now, here we put special advantage of simplicity of life in 4 dimensions, something analogous can be done in 6 dimensions, and something slightly more complicated can be done in 10. There is a general constraint in any number of dimensions, which triggers the soft stuff being constrained, and we start running into the pure spinner formalism and other interesting mathematical objects. Life is much more simple in 4 dimensions, and so we won't talk too much about anything that I would have to do with this. Alright, so let me keep going with this for a little while. So, what are the Lorentz invariants that we can build with spin holistic variance? Well, the symmetry is SL2, so the only invariant tensor we have is the epsilon symbol, nothing else. So the only thing we can do is take one spin holistic variable, another spin holistic variable, and contract them with an epsilon symbol. Less density, just put two of them side by side, and make a 2 by 2 matrix and take two of them. So, this is sometimes called, we sometimes put this inside an angled bracket, we call it lambda 1, lambda 2. If there's no confusion possible, sometimes we do this, we write it as 1, 2. Okay? And similarly, I can contract. The lambda tilde, and that's the negative square bracket. Okay? And that's it. Those are all the invariants there. Nothing else. So, let's do some familiar ones, and I'll leave factors of 2 for you to look at. Okay, but for example, let's look at something familiar, like P1.P2. Yeah. What is P1.P2? Well, what's the number telling me, oh, I have a hip problem. I can contract this guy, and I can contract the other guy. Right? And so if I write P1.P2, this is lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 1. This is lambda 2, lambda 2, lambda 2. Alpha, alpha dot, beta, beta dot, epsilon, alpha beta, epsilon, alpha dot, beta dot. Well, this is just that. Thumbs up. And then we're trying to spread it. Okay? Now, why does it have to be when we're trying to spread it? Why couldn't the answer have just been 1, 2? The reason is that remember, the momenta are invariant under this little group transformation. So if you sum lambda to W inverse lambda, and lambda total to W lambda total, the momenta don't change. So this thing had better not change. Right? This thing had better not change, but if I only had one of them, then it would have some weight under rescaling lambda 1. Okay. We're going to pay a lot of attention to the weight under that rescaling in a moment, but this is why these familiar things have to have an equal number of angle and scale back. Alright, let me say another few basic things. What is parity? What do you think parity is? Parity is what the interchange is lambda and lambda tokens. Okay? So if you have an expression and it's symmetric, if you interchange lambda and lambda tokens, it's parity. Okay? Otherwise, it isn't. It's just interchanging the two SLTs. So there's an SLT left, and it's interchanging the SLT right. Well, it's better than SLT column, SLT right. Okay, and that's also good. This P1.P2 is something which is a parity number. Okay. I want you to look at a little exercise to almost everything that you can think of. Naively, it's just everything you've got out of momenta can be expressed in terms of these angle and square brackets, and keeping them with the angle and square brackets. And here's an amusing object that I want you to play with. There's just an exercise to play with your spin of velocity muscles. You see, this is something which if you rescale any one of the variables, by rescale 2, there's a lambda 2 and a lambda total 2. Okay, so it's invariant. By rescale 3, 4, and 1, it's invariant under all of them. Okay? So this should only be a function of the momentum of the particles. Okay? But it's not parity invariant. If I interchange lambda lambda tilde, it doesn't go back to the same expression. So, any thoughts about what this object is? What do you know in four dimensions that you can build out of? Four momenta, not parity invariant. Also, so this is epsilon u1, u2, u3, u4, u1, u4. And now this is really okay, so everything you can possibly build in four dimensions, just out of momentum, is just online square brackets, and then sometimes you can get these interesting objects that are not symmetric, even though they have big GR in the language. Alright, so what are amplitudes here? So amplitudes are R, and we put it on this board because it's a thing. Yeah. No, they don't. I mean, parity interchanges it. So if you have to have a special, if you have to have a special structure to the theory for it to be invariant, it doesn't have to. So if you're just interchanging it, just if the theory is fairly invariant, then the amplitudes have to be invariant under that step. So that's actually nice. The formalism doesn't fool you into thinking that the world has to be parity invariant. It's not quite the context. It makes it very clear that you have to make a special choice for it to be so. So, what are amplitudes? Amplitudes, then, are functions of the lambda for the particle, lambda tilde. This is just a massless particle. So, I'm going to use and run to find your answer number particles. And really, this is going to be some function. It's really going to be some function of a bunch of these buckets. Lambda time. Lambda. Total lambda total time. Lambda A, lambda B. Lambda total A, lambda total B. That's all it can become then. And now there's a very beautiful thing, which is that the definition of the particles is actually encoded in the function directly. That's because we have to have the m of W inverse lambda A, the particle A, W A lambda total A, and H A, but this is simply equal to W A to the 2 A times m, the lambda, lambda total A. So when we turn a particle to spin, and that's the whole point, right? We found the object that transformed under the little group properly. So, so if we do a little group transformation on particle A, we have to pick up exactly W A to the 2 H for that extended state. The 2 is there just because W is defined for the spin half representation. So that's just a AOL convention. And in fact, the plus sign there is also an AOL convention. Correct? That's it. So in principle, I don't have to even tell you the homogeneity. Once I hand you an expression, the expression has to have a particular homogeneity. It has to have a particular rescaling property as you rescale each lambda lambda tilde individually. Okay? So let me just give you some examples. H is a homogeneity. H is a homogeneity. Well, I'm just telling you now that you don't really even need to write the H explicitly because the homogeneity that the function has under rescaling tells you what the is. So what else are we going to do just as an example? So I want to give you an example of a famous actual amplitude. This is the parallel amplitude that I alluded to before. So here's an amplitude for particles 1, 2, 3, 4. Never mind, they turn out to be blue on some color over amplitude, but the expression is 1 3 to the 4th over 1 2 2 3 2 4 4 1. And it's a very special case. For some reason, the amplitude only depends on the one kind of bracket and the other kind of bracket. These things are not generic, but I'm just writing it down so you see an example of accurately what it looks like. And now, the next thing in this expression, what are the helicities of the particle involved? Can you tell me? What's the helicity of particle 1? How do I figure out the helicity of particle 1? That's what happens to this expression when I scale lambda 1 to W lambda 1, W 1 lambda 1. So, this expression will have 4 1s upstairs, it has 2 1s downstairs. It has 4 ones up to 2 ones downstairs, so this whole thing scales like, so if I call this m, m goes to w, goes to w1 to the minus 2 m. So what is the velocity of particle 1? Minus 1. What about particle 2? Plus 1. What about particle 3? Particle 3? Minus 1. And particle 4? Plus 1. Okay? So, this is nothing to tell you that there are gluons that will be minus plus, minus plus. Isn't that true? Right? There's something else that this tells you. This is a very easy test you can do when you play with amplitudes to see if you screw something up. Does this expression make sense? This expression makes no sense, right? Because the first particle has one set of rescalings, and the second term has a totally different set of rescalings. Right? So this kind of expression is nonsense. Any expression you write down for massive amplitudes has to have each one of the books. I can have one, I can have the other, I can have both. And let's just do a little bit more practice back with this expression, just again for some fun. Okay? This might look a little bit funny. I mean, we're probably used to seeing four parts, this is a four part company. We're probably used to seeing four part company in the function of S and P and stuff like that. So I want to make this look more like S and P and stuff like that. Let's say that I write this. This 1-2, I can multiply by, let's say, 1-2 downstairs, and then 1-2 side by side. So I'll put a 1-2 here. Okay? And then next to this 2-3, I'll also put an extra factor of 2-3. Okay? And now up here, I'm going to put an extra 1-2 and 2-3 in order to make up the rest. So now what I have, something that looks like 1-3 to the fourth, just turning 1-2 and 2-3 over. And now this thing is like S, is like 2-1 plus 2-2, 2-1 dot 2-2. This next one is like 2. And then I have a factor that looks like 3-4-0-1. Okay? I'm just doing it like this. No, these are all numbers. These are all just numbers. All the brackets are just numbers. All the expressions are numbers. No, they're all to you. They're just numbers. They're just ordinary numbers. Nothing non-numbers. Okay. I'm going to read this. I don't want to read this. So I'll read it. There's one, two more steps after there, but you have to read. Interestingly, the fact, for example, you have to read the fact that 1-2, so that 1-1 is like 2-1. So I can write this, for instance, as 2-2-1-3. And then you have to use it by the Nelson translation. 2-1 is -2-2, -2-3, -2-4. So the 2-2 shows the value for the 2. The 2-3 shows 3. So this is the same as -2-4. So 3. And if you do it in all this exercise with both of these things, you find a final expression that looks like, just so you see what one of these things looks like. This whole thing is actually equal to 1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3-2-4-0-1-3- and look like they're really at a fundamental level. 90% of what I'm talking about is actually just fundamentally trivial. It's really just about big kids. There's nothing big. There's a little bit of interesting things that come to when we talk about the structure of the sleep on the faculties, where there's some deep, important things. Particularly just features. And when you see how completely trivial the stories of massive particles is, you might wonder why this hasn't been in the textbooks. And there's no deep reason for it at all. There's nothing there. There's no brilliant insight associated with it yet. But part of the problem is, and there is a massive explanation for those in the literature, but it's not as useful as the studies that I'm going to show you. But part of the problem boils down to the following totally trivial thing, like how do you think about spin? When you're thinking about spin, it's ordinary spin from your undergraduate book. Right? So, how do most people think about spin? How do you want to label the states for spin one particle? Any spin. The way you talk to do it is you have to choose to diagonalize like JZ. You diagonalize one of them, and then you break up the states into 2x plus 1 states that are labeled by the argument. So, in other words, the usual way you think about spin is to fix the overall spin of the particle, not that you can use the size. It's just the label on top. But things are labeled by the eigenstates of JZ. And if those are your labels, even for the states, then it's very hard to imagine a simple, beautiful-looking formula for properties of developing these guys. Because even with bound labels, break rotational bearings, you have to choose a spin direction. Now, if you're a conventional physicist, you're doing experiments on planet Earth, with a gravitational field that defines a new direction, and so there's a natural reason to break rotational bearings. Okay? So it's a perfectly fine. There's nothing wrong with it. But our whole objective here is to keep the symmetries as manifest as possible. So this way of labeling the states is going to be bad. Okay? What we want is a natural way of talking about two-axis of SUTs, which doesn't force us to choose a spin axis. Okay? I want to bring up, this is something which you all know how to do, forwards and backwards, probably most of you, in much fancier context, graphs, SU5, more complicated things, where you're used to dealing with tensor representations, especially with SU groups, like it's nothing. Okay? And that's actually the point, is that it's going to be much more useful to think about graphs of SU2 as micro tensors with two times the number of spin indices than the way of choosing z-axis and bridging the other body to spin in that case. I'm going to extend, and the reason this is ironic is that this tensor representation is very slightly more sophisticated than what you can teach software as an undergraduate. But in fact, it's much less sophisticated because what we teach software as undergraduates with raising and lowering operators and all that stuff is the way to generalize to any region. And does not have any of the simplicity, extra simplicity that we associate with the simplest subject number of SUP. So, what I'm telling you, what I'm about to tell you in 10 minutes, is when you should have been taught school as undergraduates, and if absolutely nothing else, you will come out of the room remembering for the rest of your life what all the stuff on the monitors are, what all the occasional relations are, all those stupid things, and the conceptual contributions. Okay? But we'll get there in a moment. In fact, it'll be motivated by just following our nose and copying what we did. But this is essentially the only reason why the formal genome family was not developed 7 years ago. It clearly could have been, but I think it's mostly the addition of people to the undergraduate way of thinking about it. But really, complete trivia. Alright, so let's go back to massive particles. Now I have a massive particle, so if I go back to this P alpha alpha dot, the determinant is not zero, so it's not rank one. Okay, so what is it? Rank 2. Okay, so there's one guy, there's the guy, and there's two of them. just caught me one day, let me say this as lambda alpha I, lambda cobra alpha dot lower x. But here, capital I just runs from 1 to 2. What is the point of doing this? You see, beforehand, we discovered the little group, the U1 of the little group, by asking what are the transformations that can do on the lambda lambda total that move the momentum quick. So now this one is right through. So what are the transformations that can do on the lambda alpha I, lambda total alpha dot I, that move the momentum quick? Just asking two on the I index. Okay? I'm not going to do that. But if I take lambda alpha I goes to uij, lambda alpha j, and lambda cobra alpha dot lower I goes to u inverse of j, lambda cobra alpha dot j, then p goes to p. So u is an SU2. If the momentum are real, so that lambda tilde is the proper conjugate of lambda, so real C1 momenta implies that U is in SU2. Okay. And so we have objects that transform under the one transformation and under little group, and they transform the little group as a something with one index. But it's an alpha representation. So what if I want to build something in which in one representation? Well, we'll come to all that in a moment. But I want to make one more comment here, which is that the determinant of P is equal to m squared, and this is equal to what I can write as the determinant of lambda times the determinant of lambda cobra. So what I mean here is it's literally lambda alpha I, lambda beta j, epsilon alpha beta, epsilon I j. Okay? In other words, beforehand, lambda was a two-dimensional vector. Now, for two two-dimensional vectors that are grouped into a two-dimensional matrix. Okay? And the determinant of lambda times the determinant of lambda tilde is equal to m squared. So there's some extra constraint here. Now, there's some little constraint on this lambda. I have to have that lambda equals, I want to call it m, that lambda tilde is m tilde. What's the constraint that m and tilde are equal to m squared? Okay? Now, you might find it convenient to keep m and m tilde separate, but it doesn't really bother anything. I might explain a little bit more later, but clearly, there's a perfectly consistent choice of just say m equals m tilde equals 0. Let me explain this point a little more because it might be important later. You see, the freedom to move around M and M tilde, only keeping the product, if you like, with the old little group transformation. The old little group transformation on the lambda. So if you start in lambda by W inverse and lambda tilde by W. Now, if I do that, I move M and M tilde around, keeping the combination of M and M tilde fixed. However, whereas beforehand we thought that this was useful, because the different velocity components, different velocities are distinguished by their weight and their real group, now it's not useful anymore, because the ratio of m over m tilde varies with it. So any formula I have with any weight, I can get any other weight by multiplying by some power of m over m tilde. So the second is massive, but overall, VR1 is not really present. In other words, if I ignore it, I can always multiply any expression by powers of m over m to destroy it, if I like. So there's no extra information that we either have or lose, like make Amazon Kilburn independent. In some cases, it's useful to pick an independent just from some areas with muscle, but not for anything that we'll see. So it's just going to affect them in the future. And that's what makes the little group literally grow in the future. If I say it in another way, if I fix M&M folder once and for all, it's the fixing of M&M folder that breaks the overall GL1. And the only thing I have left is the SCP. Okay. So any questions about this? Let's just see what it is here. Anybody recognize these equations? So the Black equation. So the Black equation that combine lambda and lambda together, and then it's the fifth term. But we're never going to need it. We'll always work with two component objects, exactly what the spin is going to have to go after that. But it tells you that you can change lambda for lambda tilde if you like, by using t. Right? If you have a lambda, another two of lambda, you've got yourself a lambda tilde, and that's much nicer. That freedom will be useful for us as you go along. Sometimes you'll be like lambda for tilde, lambda tilde, and you can switch back and forth between them too. Okay? All right. Now, let's do the cross-course of the SEQ. And again, as you guys know this, in so many fancy studies, has anyone played with SEQ5 ducks anymore? We talk about skills in index, 5-bar, and then you pick an index, upstairs, and then there's a 10, and it's symmetric, upstairs. And so you know that representations of SQL are one-to-one correspondence with tensors with any symmetry properties. So symmetry and anti-symmetry properties. And they're associated with Young Tableau. If you don't know that, you don't really need to know it. But anyway, it's just associated with the symmetrizing and anti-symmetrizing labels. That's a special fact about SQL. So not every EH does not have a useful tensor structure associated with its representation theory, but SQL does, SQL does, the fractional groups do. Okay? Now, if SQL is even simpler, right, as could be, so let's think about in this language of the tensors. What are the roots of the SQ? So let me just call the indices capital Y, because that's what we're going to do. So what is the spin of alpha representation? That's something like this has one index. What is the spin 1 of the power of 5? What is the spin 1? Well, it could have two indices. Now, I think it's symmetric and anti-symmetric parts. But because the anti-symmetric part is always contracting with the epsilon symbol, right, then it just gives me another symmetric object, something with no indices. You don't have to say that psi with no indices at all. So that's spin 0. This is spin 1/2. And so these guys symmetrize this spin 1. So in general, a symmetric representation is psi I 1 through I 2 x. It's just a tensor that has that many symmetrized indices. Let's just do some counting to see if this makes sense. So, how many degrees of freedom here? Here's 1. How many here? 2. How many degrees of freedom are there in a 2x2 symmetric matrix? Every time there are degrees of freedom for symmetric things. That's 2 times 3 divided by 2. So, this is 2 times 3 over 2. That's 3. That's correct. How many for this guy? That's 2 times 3 times 4 divided by 2 times 3 is 4. And 4. So the symmetric representation is a symmetric tensor with 2 x indices. Right, now, how is this related to what you know and what about how to relate? What is related to what you know and what is in what we know and what we normally diagonalize. What we know now, we normally diagonalize and let's say sigma z. Right? So, I'm going to define sigma z, and I'll define some tangent minus spin eigenstates to be, and then remind myself that they're in the z direction. So, sigma z half plus, we say that this is plus sigma z half, and plus, and plus and minus. So then, sigma z hat would be 1, 0, and sigma z hat minus the BFM 0, 1. Okay? So, how can I, if someone hands me a tensor, if someone hands me a collection of numbers, so for every symmetric combination of these two S-indices, what does it mean? What does it mean to give this to a collection? What does it mean that they're symmetric? Yes. Oh, it's just, these are just the eigenstates of sigma z. Here they are. 1, 0, and 0, 1. Okay? I was having to do this one. So, I don't know why it doesn't work. My note is on the key. It doesn't have to be remind you more informally what this is saying. Since these I just go from 1 to 2, what does it mean? Like, what's it say for string 1? What does it mean to say that I'm just giving you this information in IJ? It means that I'm giving you the numbers psi 1 1, psi 1 2, and psi 2 2. And 1 2 or 2 1, it doesn't matter, right? It doesn't matter what order I give it. In fact, it would be better. In order to not prejudice it, so rather than psi plus, psi plus minus, and psi minus minus. And so in general, when I'm giving you this set of numbers, I'm just giving you psi plus some string of s plus j pluses, and another string of s minus j minuses. Right? For some value of j. So some number of pluses, some number of minuses, and they add up to s. Right. So what does that look like? Right. So that's how it's in one-to-one personal, that's how there's 2s plus 1 degrees of freedom in this plot. Right. And that's also how you just read off out of psi what the individual spin components are. Right. So that literally hands you this collection of objects. If you want to now construct from it a shape in the usual way of talking about things, then you just have to wait with those numbers, the states with eigenvalue k0. So let me say this a little more, let me say this a little more formally. If I define now general data to be alpha plus theta plus z hat plus alpha minus theta z hat minus, which again is just continuation alpha plus alpha minus, then here is the formula for your dictionary. Extend the cell, it's going to be some polynomial on alpha plus and alpha minus, some number of alpha pluses, some number of alpha minuses. The number of them spans the jz to go from negative s to positive s, and the weight is nothing other than jz psi in the usual way of talking about going to the right hand side of it. Okay. So this is the correspondence between the tensor world and the undergraduate ones. Now, I'll leave one thing as an exercise for you, just because this makes life so simple. What thing you want to know, what is a general rotation matrix? What thing you want to know, what is a totally general rotation matrix for spin-offs? and you want to rotate that angle to that, right? And so you have a rising state in one direction, and you want to expand it in a linear combination of rising states in another direction. Or, you know, typically how to do it outside, because it's just the product of the 2x2 rotations for the two-dimensional representation. So we just do that outside, and now expand in the original basis, it gives you an explicit formula for the coefficients of the rotation matrix, right, for any state. So that's a little exercise for you to work out. But let me do another exercise for you in real time, because this is one that you might find useful in your everyday life a little bit more. So, by the way, go to our channel, you see, all of you, this way of talking about things, I don't have to fix a spin axis, but the object that I did can just be natural attention. And so the natural way of talking about spin axis, or the natural way of labeling massive external particles, and we're talking about saying that, because it's simply the good for the massive states, two x indices that are totally symmetric, right? And we have the object is supposed to build the lambdas and lambda filters of exactly that index. Okay, so we have to build out of them things that have the appropriate number of symmetric indices. Okay, so we'll come to that in a moment, but I just want to give you one more example of how to think about spherical harmonics in this lambda. You all know that what spherical harmonics are supposed to be, I want to build things out of a vector x, right? I want to build things out of vector x that transform as three-dimensional representations of rotation. So there's not even any fancy spinner stuff here. So that means out of x, and my language means out of x vector, I have to build something which is after building this, the symmetric EOS tensor. And I want to build them as polynomials in X. Okay? So it's poly in X. Now, first I need to get the IJ indices in time. So how do I get the IJ indices in time? It's something that you'll remember is our favorite X dot sigma matrix, right? X dot sigma is the X2 minus X2, X1 minus RX2, and X1 plus RX2. Just give me one second. Now, this matrix, however, is not a matrix with two upstairs indices, or two downstairs indices. So there's one upstairs index and one downstairs index. And you know that has to be true because this matrix conjugates. It's actually two on one side and the other. So you've got the value on one side and on the other. So it has one upstairs and one downstairs index. That's good because one of the defining properties of this matrix is that it's traceless. So z negative z is traceless. And so that means that when I put out these two indices, I have to have zero. And that also you see is what's annoying about having representations where you have upstairs and downstairs indices. So you have to put in by hand the restriction that they're traceless. And the usual way of thinking about harmonics or other orthogonal polynomials like this is to trace those conditions, like start involving some common goals and keeping track of now, all of that goes away the second we work with just purely downstairs indices. Okay, so that is the same, but let's go to your question. So, where did this come from? Well, I'm just trying to connect to this description in the description you know as an undergraduate. That's exactly what I'm saying. This object psi doesn't take any direction. Okay? But if you want to see how this object psi is related to your thing you know as undergraduate, when you do take a direction, psi doesn't take a direction, but this guy is going to the same term. And what I was telling you, if you want to see what it is in another representation, you just have to do the individual 2x2 transformations on this and read off what it does. Okay? And that's how you get the general rotation matrix. And there's a very pretty simple formula for it, a bunch of N through K type objects, which you've probably seen in the back of that textbook, which optional variations, but this is the support for the voters. But I don't want to spoil that one for you, so that you really should do yourself. However, I will spoil the time set, I'll spoil the democracy. So let's see what we have to do instead here. So what we want to do more easily is actually work with another matrix, which is our downstairs indices. Okay? So what is that matrix? And I just go on there. Look up the sign. If I just break lower with the epsilon symbol, and then I got negative epsilon minus I x3, 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 positive x1, plus x. You see, this matrix you probably haven't seen. Sine theta due to the alpha, cos theta, positive sine theta due to the minus alpha. Right? And those are the trigonometric system one. Okay? And let's say for spin two. For spin two, I want to write down that x I 1 j 1, x I 2 j 2. Right? And these are all symmetric in IJ, but I somehow want to symmetrize all the indices. There's actually an extremely simple way of doing that. If all you want to do is say, this is going to be my pi, I1, J1, I2, J2. So I'm symmetrizing all those indices. But remember, to extract the components of the wave function in the z direction, which are defined to be the self-harmonics in this case, all I want to do is contract this vector into the same vector over and over again. Right? So this is like z, I1, C, J1, C, I2, C, J2, times X, I1, J1, X, I2, J2. But this is otherwise known as C, C, X, all squared. And if that's any string, it's just C, C, X to the power of the string. Now, what is C, C, X? So, C, C, X is just minus alpha plus squared, x minus I, y, plus 2 alpha plus alpha minus x. Do you mind if I switch that? X 1 minus I, 3, plus 2 alpha plus alpha minus x 3, plus I'm just dotting this 2 by 2 matrix into C plus. Okay? All right, and so P, Q, X. For the power of X, it's just this thing. Now when we work with a unit vector, now when we just prepare that X is a unit vector, that just picks up the overall part of the radius. If I prefer that X is a unit vector, Q, Q, X, Q, X is equal to, alpha plus squared sine theta in the alpha, not I plus 2 alpha plus alpha minus plus theta, minus alpha minus squared sine theta to the minus alpha to the power of x. And this, by definition, is just equal to the sum. This is the generating function for all the squared harmonics. So alpha plus the x plus the z, alpha minus the x minus the z, y, x, and z, z. That's the main factor. So that's the way to remember sovereign monarchy in the middle of the night. Someone comes and puts a gun to you in the middle of the night and says, what's their fixed point? What are they? Right? They all know there's a statue and a diagonal, it's a couple of us, right? You know? But what keeps you up in the power of your faith? That's the only way. It's the trivial way of making the
Thank you.
being poor, these are nothing. Well, sin, in this example, half and two. And these are masters. Well, Felicity's plus three lives and minus one. Okay. And now I just want to write down an expression for what some legal amplitude can look like. So, it has to be something which has one I index for particle one. It also has four symmetries I indices for particle two, and also has some appropriate weights in particles two and three. Okay, so here's an example. Two terms that I can have here for something like four. So one, two, four. And maybe there's some couple of times to pop it here, there's some times to climb. And four, one, two. So let's just take a look here and see why I'm saying this. Let's look at the master cases. So three, for Felicity plus three lab, and there's one, there's the three weights for the lab of total three. Okay? So that's what we have. Out of the four, we have weight minus one. So from here, it's still negative one, so I have to pick up the factor of W. W1, W4, and minus 2, so that's the two angle brackets of 4 do that. So this top expression is legal for particle 2 and 4. And what about particle 2? It's supposed to have 4 indices. So there's 2J1, 2J2, 2J3, 2J4. That's for particle 2, and one index for particle 1. Yeah. And I'm going to just manually symmetrize. Just imagine manually symmetrize. Expression in J1 to J4. Okay. Now, what about this other one? What is in fact to see it has all the same weights and has the right number of ones and twos? Okay. And there are other terms you can write down as well. Now, I'm writing a different way to emphasize something. In these nothing guys, they have an index. I'm writing down expressions for these things, this is actually not a good example for this one. I'll say it when I can do my research. Instead here, I want to do something else. So, this might make it so, is it clear that that is the illegal expression? All you have to do is just write anything down that's made out of the angle brackets. By the way, is it clear what this means? Everything in a square bracket means that I've just contracted. So, this thing is lambda cobra 2 alpha dot J1 lambda cobra 3 beta dot epsilon alpha dot beta dot. Okay? So everything that's brackets, angle and square brackets, is just contracted, with the Exelons are really much better off without motor than before. The only difference between Maxis and Maxis is that now the Maxis landers and lander triggers have an extra index set. That's it. Otherwise, every instruction is exactly the same. Left on funnels with landers and lander triggers. Now you just have to grab some of the ones with lander triggers with indices. And the landers and lander triggers with indices in the public of Maxis. And you have to make sure by the end of the day they're just specifically the correct number of this. You have to do two estimates. You only have to make sure the correct number because then you can synchronize by them. Okay? And then you have to an appropriate expense. Now, this might look at seem like a little bit cumbersome. This notation might be a little cumbersome because you're dragging all these extra indices around. But it's actually quite cumbersome for the same reason that we just saw in our little stable harmonic calculation that we're making. There ain't actually any point in dragging these indices around explicitly because we know at the end of the day we're just going to synchronize them. Okay? So, again, notational thing, start writing down. We're not going to write them down. I just have to remind myself which particles are massive and which particles are massive. If I'm doing this on top, I'll write the massive ones in boldface. If I'm doing it on the blackboard, I just put a little underline on them to remind myself that the guys are massive. So if I do that, this expression becomes, I'll put a little underline to remind me that particle 2 is massive. And then, kappa 1, 2, 4, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, plus kappa 5, and the kappa 5, and 4, 1. Okay? So you just underline. Oh, yes. So remember, whenever you see anything in angle brackets, it means epsilon alpha beta. It goes along with the lambda. It's lambda 1 alpha, lambda 2 beta. So they put 1i, 2 means lambda 1i, particle 1 with massive. Okay? So they put in This is, I'm sorry, thank you, I should explain that. I didn't explain that. Q2 lambda 4 is something that has an alpha dot index. So, if you like, this is P2, alpha, alpha, dot, lambda, 4, alpha. And I'm just writing it down again, and subtracting the alpha, dot, and the beta. And that's it. Thank you. Okay. So, you see, the notation is now identical. But this line is a lambda token, whether they're massive or massive, there's no difference. When they're massive, they're bordered or underlined. And even the rule of the thing, if you have to have an expression, which when it's massive, it has just a net 2x of them in total. The total number of lambdas around the circuit, whatever it is that's there, the total number of them are underlined. The total number has got to be 2x, but if it's not just, you have to have the right rule. And that's it. And every expression like that that you write down is kinematically illegal. So before I close, I'll just give you another 5 minutes. I want to show you just random examples. I want to show you some actual entities here to in this language. But maybe before doing that, let me just say, because we've just done kinematics today, what I'll do. I'll make another quick comment. Which is how we put that money into the limit. Now, this is something that you all know intuitively. That the master's property, the master's property has more degrees of freedom than the master's one. And so somehow the high energy amplitude has got to break up or decompose somehow into all the different ways that you can break. And you know this is part of the drama, the change mechanism, and WW star rate, and all of that stuff. And in the conventional language, you know, there's a difference between the polarization vectors and the Lorentz transverse components, and all of the rest of that stuff. Right? But this way of trivializing the kinematics also trivializes the correspondence. Right? And let me explain why. So, in order to do that, I'm simply going to say that lambda alpha, I, now you see lambda alpha, good I went from 1 to 2, if I think of this as a vector in I space, I can decompose it as a sum of two vectors in any basis that I like. So, for instance, I can decompose this as lambda alpha times some ci, plus lambda tilde plus beta alpha times some q tilde I. In fact, I better say this as I plus I and q minus I. This is, for example, these could be the, these two could be the eigenstates in the direction of motion in part. I can do anything that I want, but that's where I have to come in with choice. And lambda and eta are independent spirits. Now, because I have that c plus, c minus is equal to 1, I have to have that lambda eta is equal to m, because I want to have the determinant of lambda equals m. And then, we can then easily work out that lambda tilde alpha dot is, right? And it's just lambda tilde alpha dot. But this thing, when it gets conjugated, goes to a c minus I, and then I have some eta tilde alpha dot, and that gets conjugated, goes to a c plus I. So, let's say I have some expression. So suppose I have some expression, and we'll find counterexample to this in very degenerate cases like three particle kinematics, which we'll spend a long time talking about tonight. But if we just do it for a simple thing, imagine I have some expression which is built out of lambdas and lambda tildes. It can have ion joinages and so on, and it can depend on the mass of your particle. But that this expression is smooth as the mass of the particle goes to zero. In other words, I just need an expression that has no property of 1 over n in it, or something like that. Remember, precisely because of that Dirac equation type relationship, I can always convert a lambda to a p over n times lambda tilde. So I can always take any expression and make it look worse by multiplying it by p over n. Okay? I can take a lambda and replace my p over n lambda tilde, and it doesn't make any difference. But suppose you have some expression that has been written in a way where there's no one of the ends of it. The expression is smooth, the limit of the mass of the particle is to zero. Okay? Then, the high energy limit then corresponds to this sending, for example, eta to zero. And the high energy limit then is then just corresponding to eta to zero. What then happens is that you get the energy limit, you just drop the bars. You just take any expression you have, and you just drop the bars. And you unbolt it and break that. And then you have an expression that now looks like it's a massless particle. But I'll show you an example. It will actually contain all the different velocity components, and you can actually read off of all the different velocity components on the one under that mathematics. So let me show you how this works an example, I'd like to end with this. So let me just give you an example of Compton Stutter. Okay? Two-level Compton Stutter. It is a classic thing that we do. Tomorrow we'll go on to but I want to a Compton Stutter replicates a particle of 1, photon 2, photon 3, particle 4. So this is going to be 1, this is a particle of spin s. This is a photon 1. Minus the plus photon in particle and I'm just going to compute this at 2 level. And this is what the answer looks like. This is the q squared over s minus m squared u minus m squared. I'm going to write down the answers. It's been 0, 1, and a half and 2. I want you to know a few things about this number. This number is first, it's extremely simple. You can check that there's right number of bars that each one is right, everything is okay. No projectile below a spin a half particle. There's no U bars and Vs, there's no splashes, right? There's no dollar matrices. Depends on how the electron is spin a half. So I have two components of this shift. Notice also that for the W case, charge spin matches to the M particle, we discovered that the W amplitude is like the square of the spin a half amplitude. That's something that you probably didn't know. There are all these sort of simple hidden relationships between the scattering amplitude, and they're totally obvious by this square thing. But by the way, what do I mean by this? I literally mean the expression in bracket 2 is squared, and this thing is in bracket. Okay? Okay? So, as I said, you've probably never seen the Compton scattering amplitude, actually. Okay? But there it is. That's a full lecture. But now, what's the energy limit? The energy limit is that I just dropped the bars. So let me give you an example. Let's give you an example of the energy limit for W. Okay? Energy limit for W compensation. So, I'm just going to write 1 over SU because I can't ignore the mass. So that's fine. But then I'm just going to get. I'm just going to get 1 bar 2, 4 bar 3, plus, and this is just interesting in 1 and 4, plus 4 bar 2, 1 bar 3, squared. Okay, and as I said, when I'm in the limit, I just drop the bar. Okay. So, this is E squared over S U, 1 2 squared, 2 4 squared, plus 1 2 3 4, plus 3 1 3, and the next factor is 2, plus 4 2 squared, 1 3 squared. Now, let's look at this expression. His expression might strike you as a little bit funny. Remember when the particles are massive, I told you there's something you're not allowed to do. You're not allowed to add particles of different expression of different velocity rates to get. These things have different velocity rates, right? In this expression, what is the spin of particle one? Minus one, right? What about particle four? So this is one minus four plus. What about here? It's 1 plus 4 minus. What about here? 0, 4. And indeed, that's how the massive amplitude contains all the velocity components in the different pieces. The massive amplitude is unified in the different velocity components into one object. And you discover it when you drop the balls. Now, beforehand, when the bars were there, it was definitely legal to combine these objects together. Remember? Remember I told you there was no overall energy associated with these throwing and random around the children, the particles were massive. The mass form broke that. Then in that high energy limit, that little group chemistry sort of emerges and tells you that it's good to decompose the amplitudes in terms of, to decompose the amplitudes in terms of the velocity rate. And that's how the massive object splits up into a bunch of older independent component massive things. And you learn which ones. Right? You just drop the bars, and then you just take the different velocity components. By the way, you notice that the numerator here is very small amplifier to you. If you notice that this numerator up here is exactly the same as this big zero numerator up there. Okay? So you discover that the longitudinal component of this W acts exactly like the charge scale of the Now, I'd like to get a little foreshadowing here of what we'll talk about in the last day when we talk about the Higgs mechanism, is that making things massive is actually unifying things in the perspective of amplitude. It's not breaking things, it's unifying them. It's taking component massive velocity amplitudes and figuring out how to unify them, much like Georgia unified, you know, the particle change went from a standard ball into a 5 ball plus 2. They're literally taking the different velocity components of massive particles and finding how it's possible in some cases to unify them together into massive bits. It's an infrared unification, not an ultraviolet unification. The Higgs mechanism is actually a way of tying together more neatly into a smaller package a bunch of independent velocity component amplitudes. And you get a very high energy unification that's harder and harder to see. The thinking, the emotions about it are exactly the opposite of what we normally think about associated with the this is an early indication of the kind of associated results that we're going to be seeing. All right, so that's it for kinematics. I hope you now know what the amplitudes depend on, and we've seen some examples of what they look like. We've seen some fruits of the labors that we will go through tomorrow and Friday. So we'll derive all of these things. So we'll derive these things from first principles. We're not only touching on the ground game, we're finding rules, and it's just directly what ground game is the result. But starting tomorrow, we're going to be doing actual physics, and not just the quality of the universe, including every factor of T, every minus time, everything is fixed.